Dr. Husa is no stranger to our school. He was here last year at the beginning of Sound Celebration, where his concerto for orchestra was performed on this stage by the Louisville Orchestra. In 1981, he was commissioned to write a ballet, The Trojan Women, and he came to the school at that time to conduct the orchestra for their premiere performance in this hall. He's a Pulitzer Prize winning composer, as you will note from the sketch in your program, and further information about his background is available there. I'm particularly pleased that we honor today not only a great composer, but a teacher, a musician, composer, conductor, who spent 38 years in academia. He was on faculty at Cornell University from 1954 to 1992, and influenced the lives of many, many students during that time. So without further ado, it is with a great deal of pleasure that we present to Dr. Husa the award, the medallion signifying the 1993 Grawemeyer Award for Music Composition.
Atomic Energy Commission with California has premiered the piece. The other inspiration somehow came from a movie that I have seen at the time, and that brings us to what music and art sometimes is. And that is that it depicts what we live in our time. And I think that as much I would like to escape sometimes, if I would like to escape, but I don't, it is impossible for me to write other music than the music of things that I see around me. And one of those things was the Rain Man, which was played by Hoffman. The other thing was the freedom that was coming in Europe. And I wrote the piece in 1987, 88. And I remember that the freedom idea was coming all over the Europe. It started in China, and then it started all over the Europe. We cannot perform the work this year here, I think mainly because Mr. Lynn Harrell has been already booked for 4 years ahead, and the piece has been dedicated to him. But I hope sometime in the future you may hear it. But in that piece, I have also introduced the French hymn Marseillaise, but I have hidden it in such a way that nobody would know it except the timpani player. And you admit with me that it's a little innovation to give four first measures of Marseillaise to the timpani player. Because it's melodic, yet it is there in the last movement, which I call hymn. And when it was rehearsed by the symphony, the timpani player immediately noticed that, and he was saying it, said it to his colleagues, and the colleague said it to Mr. Lewis, the conductor, and he said, "But we don't hear it." And Mr. Lewis telephoned me and said, "Mr. Husa, you should put a tuba with that, and with your permission, I will do it." So he didn't even wait for my consent. But with his permission, he has put it in. And at the first performance in 1990, it was exciting. But now, when the freedom has been gained in those countries, I will take the tuba out, and it will only be in the timpani. I have written some program notes that might interest you to say a few words about the war. After the war, I left Prague to pursue studies in Paris and had the chance to hear the French school and its great cellist. Yet, until now, I have written for this 5-octave range instrument, that is the cello, only in my chamber and orchestra music. It was then a great pleasure to be invited to write a concerto for Lynn Harrell, whom I have admired for a long time. Because of the rich literature for this instrument, many sonorities, much of technique, and some of the highest ranges have been already explored, especially when we include the harmonic pitches, we can even extend the 5-octave range. Hopefully, I have found some new path, but mostly I have been concerned in writing music that would belong to our time, music of today. Naturally, as the title suggests, a concerto is a work in which the virtuosic and technical aspect of the solo part, as well as the dialogue between the cellist and the orchestra, are of great importance. Also, I hope it will reflect the enjoyment of music making and listening, the excitement of living in this world, much of progress, yet with such basic problems as freedom, respect for man, and nature unfulfilled. This concerto is composed in five parts. There's the introduction that I start with the cello, all cellos in the lowest register, and the piece will end in the highest register at the end. That would be a symbol that has been used by many composers, including Bach already, so it's nothing new. When we present music that would raise constantly from the beginning to the end, we feel there is a hope. There's a recitative also for the cello, in which the cello speaks practically by itself. There may be a symbol of man alone. There's an anecdote, just to change it from most serious to something rather funny, and the cello plays pizzicato in the highest registers, and that was probably the most difficult movement that Mr. Harrell has ever seen, but he has played it very beautifully. Remembrance is a slow meditative movement, and the last part is a hymn climaxing at the conclusion, in which the cello solo soars up to his highest register, perhaps reminiscent of a flight of birds. Albatross come to my mind, but it would be presumptuous to think one could succeed in appropriately expressing such a magnificent exploit. And when I spoke about the Rain Man, it's in the remembrance that I remember the difficulties that we all have communicating to people who have this illness. I think this is about all I would mention about the concerto for cello. I never dreamed in my life that that would be a work that could receive the Grawemeyer Award, but of course I am honored and delighted about it. And I will cherish the award, and I will cherish the concerto even more now. But we thought that you would like to hear some live music that I have written, and we have for you a sonata a tre that I have composed in 1981, and I have written for three soloists that I have known for years, and that have founded all together a trio called Werder Trio. Miss Werder is the clarinetist, Mr. Werder is the violinist, and Mr. Kirkpatrick, pianist in that trio. I call it sonata a tre. It's not in the classical sense that would be like Beethoven's music or Mozart or Brahms or even Dvořák's music, that it would have a form of sonata as we know from classical period. But it would be more as a sonata as we know from Baroque period. And I have written the following. The title sonata refers not only to the classical meaning of the sonata, but rather to the early Baroque meaning of the word. The music, however, is part of today's world, as new possibilities of techniques, individual and collective, have been used and new sounds explored. Sonata a tre is written in a virtuosic manner and hopefully for the excitement of solo and chamber music making. It is dedicated to Werder Trio. It was performed for the first time in Hong Kong, and I would have thought that probably that would be a place that the sonata would not be understood, but to my surprise, it was a great success. I'm not saying that everywhere the piece is played is a great success, but I would say that I was surprised that in Hong Kong it worked. The first movement features the violin as a soloist. The second movement features the piano as a solo instrument, and the last movement features the clarinet. And I would like to introduce the performers who were so kind and lend a piece, which by no means is easy, and I have never learned how to write an easy music, and at my age of 72, I probably will never learn it anymore. The performers of the Cheruti chamber players are Cherryline Kelly violin, Grace Bobenet piano, and Ernest Gross clarinet. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
due to the tremendous virtuosity of our performers. Yes, please.
What are you working on now? What lies ahead?
Well, I'm working on a piece for wind ensemble for Northwestern University, 100 years, and the retirement of the conductor there, Mr. John Painter. Then I'm writing a woodwind quintet for Kusevitsky Foundation, and then I have to write a piece for Chicago Symphony. So there are a lot of things ahead, and a lot of happiness and a lot of frustration for my family. Yes.
When you compose, are you primarily working from the piano? When you the violin concerto, were you actually playing some of these passages on violin? Do you have perfect pitch?
No, I don't think both answers will be no, but let me say I don't think I have a perfect pitch, but like many violinists, and I have heard the A constantly, so I always refer to that. And I have never learned, because I was violinist, and I have learned piano as a second instrument, so I don't compose at the piano. So most of the things I write just on the paper. And in the place where I write mostly my music, which is in the summer place on the lake Cayuga, where I hear all these birds and that I have transcribed them, according to Beethoven, the same thing, because Beethoven said about the pastoral symphony that the cuckoo and all these sounds were written by the birds in Heiligenstadt. So I thought my birds will come from Cayuga Lake. And I don't have a piano there, so I mostly don't write, but I try some of the sounds, I do try at the piano, but obviously I am always disappointed with the sound because I'm not a good pianist. So one has to be a good pianist in order to hear the sounds well. Thank you.
What are you doing for voice composition, chorus, that sort of thing?
Choral composition. I haven't written too much, but and reason was very curious. When I left Prague in 1946, I was 25 years old, and I might have started to write something for voice. But I left for Paris and my French was not very good, so I didn't dare to write in French for voice. And by the time I was ready to write, I thought, because I loved the poems by Eliard, Aragon, and all the French modern poets, by the time I had learned sufficiently French, I had left for United States. And then it was for several years, the same thing with my English. When I write, I write both. I can write what one would call idiomatically for voices and for choruses. I have written Moravian songs, which are very simple songs, and a little piano in it, and it's nearly the way it has been sung in Moravia. But sometimes I get also out of my way to try something new and create sometimes sensation among the choral conductors and singers too, because I give them some things that imitate the nature too. And I think that the voice has the possibility to do those things too. So I have an American Tedeum in which at one part there is description of the Apollo spacecraft going up, and I think that's the part that the students at Cornell enjoyed most, because they could do practically whatever they wanted, from lowest voice to up to high, and I try sometimes impossible, I would say. Yes.
Will you use any of the computer technology available in the software to hear some of the music?
No, unfortunately I got so behind in that race with computers. I started with Mr. Moog in Ithaca, who was very much interested in working with me, but then he was changing the machines and I was traveling, and I got so much behind that I am absolutely amateur in what all these instruments mean, and my grandson, who is 10-11 years old, knows much more than I do about it. And I think it's a little too late for me, but so I still write scores with my hand, and as far as the electronic sounds, yes, I am interested in those, and I try to transcribe them or bring them into the instruments that we have, and I think that's in some way that I do it also, because I think that we have these wonderful players and they can play it, and that some of the electronic sounds, not only the sounds from the nature, but there are some electronic sounds in the nature too. So I try to transcribe them into the instrument. But had I been younger, I would have been definitely interested in these new things. But time is running on out on me. Yes.
In small ensembles, as we heard today, is there a combination of instruments that you like better than others?
No, I get intrigued about any combination, and I think it's also due to my teacher and the teaching I got in the past. As a composer, you have to be nearly like a shoemaker, and you have to be able, or you have to make a shoe for every foot. So whether it's child or bigger and larger, so it's that sort of excitement that you make for yourself some goal that this should be for this ensemble. So I enjoy any ensemble. I enjoy putting the unusual ensemble, which it is, violin, piano, and clarinet. I enjoy that as much as writing for orchestra or wind ensemble. I have written a lot of pieces, a lot of music for wind ensemble, because I, aside from orchestra, I always was impressed by the sound of wind ensemble. And when finally I had written the first piece, the saxophone concerto, and then music for Prague, I was asked to write for that. So I have written a lot, but any ensemble and any combination, I think, is intriguing to me.
This is just an observation.
Yes, sir.
But the use of the clarinet in the piano using that sound box, that was the most interesting effect.
Yes.
I'm going to try that with my clarinet at home.
I see.
But it was very interesting.
Yeah. It vibrates because the piano has the pedal down, the pianist, you see. So playing in it, it's not only the sound of the clarinet, but the strings vibrate in it. And I wish I were the composer who used it the first time, but it was a clarinetist in Buffalo whose name is Mr. Duffalo. It's absolutely true. His name is Richard Duffalo, D-U-F-F-A-L-O, and he was with a new group in Buffalo. I came there and I had this effect. Lucas Foss also uses this effect. So we somehow, like composers, we pass on what we have learned somewhere, what we think interesting, and we just expose it for others. And if any of the composers here is interested in that effect, please use it. Thank you for the question. Yes, sir. That's a really very difficult question. You mean about, did you say living composers? Yes, that's the most difficult question. There are so many, and I would say that even about composers of the past, you see, sometimes I am asked about What is your favorite composer in all times? And when I was studying, for instance, B minor mass, Bach, I thought this is the greatest work written. Then I studied Missa Solemnis, Beethoven, and when I saw the construction, I thought this is magnificent music. And it would be the same, would it be Berlioz's Requiem or Fantastic Symphony, Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. To me, the first movement is something so incredibly powerful and driving for 10 minutes, and how a mind, only a genius, could write 10 minutes of music that drives so incredibly ahead with two notes is still a mystery to me. So every time I get wrapped into, and then I listen to Debussy, and I think it's magnificent. And with the living composers, if I may say just this, that I have always thought that Olivier Messiaen was the greatest living composer, but he died last year. So they are. I'm interested in all directions. And I would, I hope this answer somehow will satisfy you, and it will satisfy me, I'm sure. When I have four daughters, and I love them all most dearly. So any living composer who devotes his or her time to writing music and hope that one day one will be understood, to me, it's a profession which I admire, because it's a rather hard profession. Because we are so many of us write music, and it's a pity that not many of us can be successful. Gunther Schuller said that according to the BMI